Ladies and gentlemen, friends and family, we're gathered here today to remember and give thanks for the lives of our dear Peter and Celia, and to show our love and support for those who are grieving at this time. I'd like to invite you to join in singing one of Celia's favorite hymns. This was found requested in her notes. And if you use the second leaf of the program that has her name and photo, you'll be able to sing along. If you'll please rise when the music begins, and we'll rise to sing. Please bow your heads as we pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before you here in this place as we come to say goodbye to our dear loved ones. We ask that your mercy and grace and compassion will touch each heart here. Remember Jesus, who himself wept at the graveside of his friend, and we know that his presence will be with us here today. So comfort the bereaved, the grieving, and let the inspiration of the lives that these two lived be a source of strength for each of us as we continue on with life. We thank you that you promise to be with us even in times of sorrow and trial. And we thank you for your presence here today. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Pastor Alistair Powell will now bring us a message of comfort.
Today, we spend time in remembering and sharing the lives of Peter and Celia, whose lives were taken so suddenly together. As we do this, we turn to the Word of God to find strength and comfort and hope during these moments. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 12, that death has passed upon all men. And we know this by experience. Death will touch one of us, all of us, at some point in our lives. Death brings together the two strongest human emotions, love and grief. And it's when these two emotions combine, it's what makes a death so difficult sometimes to deal with. It can become overwhelming. However, death was never meant to be part of the human race. It was not in God's plan for anyone to die. Man's destiny was to live, and to live forever. Because we have the presence of sin in this world, we also have the presence of death. But God, as he considered mankind, he devised a plan. And that plan was to send Jesus Christ, his Son, down to this world. And we read this in John chapter 3, verse 16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish," that means not die forever, "but shall have everlasting life." You see, God took these two emotions, love and grief, and he used one to destroy the other. He used love to destroy grief. When Jesus died upon the cross, the Bible says that he died for every man. He came here to suffer and die that we might not suffer the loss of eternity. He came here to put an end to the emotion of eternal grief. He wanted to turn death into something that appeared eternal, into something that was now temporal. In the book of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10, the Bible gives us this wonderful promise of truth. It says, "But now is made manifest the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel." The Bible says that Jesus Christ has abolished death, the power of death, to hold a man, a woman, a child in the grave. When Peter and Celia heard the gospel in their lives, they embraced it. It was paramount, central to their lives. Their faith in the power of Christ to deliver them from sin and death was steadfast. And they have the promise, as all believers have the promise, that death cannot hold one who believes in Christ. Jesus, as he walked with his disciples, tried to demonstrate to them how he had broken the power of death over mankind. As he was approaching one of his friends, Lazarus, who had passed away, he used an illustration of sleep to demonstrate how death is temporal to the believer. I'd like to read here from the book of John, chapter 11, verse 11 to 14. It says, "These things said he, and after he says to them, 'Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him out of sleep.' Then said his disciples, 'Lord, if he sleeps, he shall do well.' Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought he had spoken of taking rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So Jesus takes death and he compares it to going to sleep. You know, when you've had a long, hard day's work, and you climb into bed at night time, and your head hits that pillow, it's a good feeling. There's no fear in going to bed at night. There's no fear in going to sleep. And Jesus tried to use this to demonstrate that when you believe in him, there's no fear in death anymore. It's just like going to sleep every night. You know, when you go to sleep, you forget the day. And you look forward to the new day, don't you? There's no cares, there's no worry, there's no stress, there's no pain in sleep. Just perfect peace. But there's one thing about sleep that Jesus compares here that is the most beautiful of all. And he says it in John chapter 11:11. He says to them, "Oh, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him out of sleep." You see, what makes sleep non-fearful when we go to bed at night is the hope that we shall wake up in the morning. If we didn't have the hope that we wake up the next day, we would be a bit afraid to go to sleep. But we have a hope. Every night we have a hope when we go to bed, that we wake up in the morning. And that same hope we can have that when we rest and sleep, we will be woken up in the morning. You know, sometimes we like our sleep so much, we need an alarm clock to wake us up. Do you know that there is a special alarm clock? In fact, there's only one alarm clock that can wake up the dead. And Jesus illustrates here in the book of John chapter 11. Then they took away the gravestone from the place where Lazarus was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me." And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." And he that was dead came forth. There's no power in humanity of themselves to raise the dead, to awaken someone who's fallen asleep. But there is a voice, one voice, the voice of the Son of God. When he calls forth, it's like an alarm clock that wakens up the dead. Peter and Celia chose to believe in the power of Jesus Christ. And we can believe that the voice of Christ will awake them as it awoke Lazarus. In fact, Jesus says in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 18, "I am he that liveth and was dead, but behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of hell and of death." You see, Christ has the keys. He has the power to break the bonds of death. And he's used it, and he will continue using it for all who believe. The Apostle Paul cements this truth as he expresses the same sentiments in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. It says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope." Because when we find Christ as our Savior and believe in him and his power
to raise the dead. Yes, we do sorrow when we lose a loved one. That's natural.
But we can sorrow with hope. We don't have to sorrow with despair. We can sorrow with hope. Because it says, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven, and with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. You see, that same voice that awoke Lazarus is the same voice that awakes all who believe. And it says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. When you go to sleep at night time, and you wake up in the morning, it's a different day from the day before. For someone who dies believing Christ, we leave this world behind, but we wake up to a new world. One completely different. And the Bible says in Revelation chapter 21, verse 3 and 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more pain, death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Just like yesterday is gone, so this world will be gone, and everything with it. And we will wake up to a new world, a paradise, a heaven, where there's no pain and sorrow, no loss of loved ones anymore. And the reason why there is no pain and sorrow and death is because there's no sin there. Sin will be gone. The first face that Lazarus saw when he came forth from the grave was the very one whose voice awakened him. It was the face of Christ. And everyone who is awoken by the power of Christ, the first face they shall behold will be him, the one who resurrected him from the dead. You see, death to the believer, instead of being the end of all things, actually becomes the beginning of all things. Death becomes just a step or a moment, a passing of time between this world and the world to come. There's no greater hope the Bible offers at this moment in time than the hope of eternal life through Christ. We can have assurance that by the grace of God we shall see Peter and Celia again if we share the faith in Christ as they did. Believing in that hope of eternal life. Sometimes at these moments we wonder if God really understands what we're going through. There's so many emotions when we lose a loved one. It's hard to express to someone, hard to show how we really feel, and hard for them to understand. And sometimes we wonder, does God really understand what we're going through? Well, God also has lost a loved one dear to him. He had a son who walked on this world, and his life was taken prematurely. It was taken for no reason of his own. At 33 years of age, he was nailed to a cross. The strength of grief is measured by the strength of life. You see, if someone passes away and you don't really know them, you feel sorrow, but not extensive grief. But of course, if you love someone, the longer you have loved them, the stronger that relationship, then the stronger the feelings and emotion of grief when they pass. You see, God did not only live with his son for 33 years, they existed for eternity. And we could only imagine the measure of grief he would have suffered when for the first time in eternity death separated them, that union. So God understands how we feel. And he can offer us comfort at this time. I'd just like to close our thoughts this morning by leaving us with a wonderful promise found in the Bible. As I put these thoughts together, I didn't realize that this was one of Peter's favorite verses, and it's inside his program here. It's from the book of Isaiah, chapter 41, verse 10. It says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." It's a wonderful promise and a wonderful comfort. And I pray this morning that the family may be comforted by the promises and assurance that we find in the Word of God. Amen.
We'll now invite Matthias forward. It's Peter's younger brother. He has a reading for us.
As already read, Isaiah 41, verse 10. Fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of thy righteousness, my righteousness. Then on the back of the program is another verse of my brother Peter. In Romans 8, verse 37 to 39. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Eulogy for Peter will be read by Christina. It's Peter's younger sister.
Papa the Peter. Peter Siegfried Thiel was born, and I didn't mean to cry, and it'll get better, was born on the 7th of March, 1941, in Sprotow, Silesia, now Poland. I remember my mother saying he was an amazingly good baby who fed and slept and grew. As a toddler, he became the sunshine of the family with his ready smile and lovely curly hair. No doubt his 2.5-year-older brother Dieter and 1.5-year-older sister Anita presented him with some challenges, and he had to learn to assert himself. At age 3, a baby sister, Christina, was added to the mix. And later followed John, and much later, Matthias. Peter was precious to each one of us. He brought sunshine and fun. Into the family unit. He was a monkey, and he made us laugh. His life influenced us in maybe different ways, but the impact and preciousness remains. Precious memories of our brother will remain in the hearts of each one of us, and I will share some of these memories with you. Dieter, the eldest, recalls, I discovered my brother as a friend after migrating to Australia. We had brotherly bonding times attending a coffee shop in Adelaide, which catered for international clientele, where we competed to attract charming girls. However, my fondest memory is my visit from Germany to Peter and Celia's home in Lismore. I accompanied Peter on his postal run, and he almost succeeded in making me car sick. I remember the pleasure visiting Rebecca in her legal office and Joanna in the dental surgery and persuading them to come and share some family time. That evening, which we all spent together, will remain as a precious memory to me. Anita, the big sister, has precious memories, and she says, as we were growing up, we had to help our mother to be food gatherers. One day she said to Peter and to me, you two go to the forest and get some blueberries. Here are the buckets and don't come back until they are full. Oh, those buckets were big. So we took off to the railway station, caught the train and got to the forest. It took almost the whole day to fill those buckets and our backs were breaking. After walking back to the railway station, there was a long wait on the platform for the train to come. We got so bored, we started clowning around. We must have amused our other fellow passengers, so we clowned around even more and had fun at the same time. When the train arrived, we all got on board and we were quite content that we had made them laugh, because at that time there was not much to laugh about. Times were very hard. Winter also brought lots of fun for us. Snowball fights were irresistible. Oh, the jubilation when one hit the target. But Peter did not take kindly to being a target, and his retribution was swift, with a handful of soft snow being rubbed into the face. A cool surprise. We have lived and lived well.
Goodbye, my brother. I'll see you in the morning.
John remembers, being the youngest in the family while still in Germany, I always had a special place in my heart for Peter. I looked up to him as my hero. Then in Australia, we eventually worked together as bricklayers, and gradually, to my joy, we were able to blend our faith in God. I recall no negatives in our relationship and thus feel deeply the loss of a very dear brother. Celia grew equally dear to me, and this combined loss is felt deeply by all of us. Matthias, the baby of the family, says, one of the highlights of my school holidays were the days spent at Peter's and Celia's place. Later, I was privileged to work with Peter and my father as a bricklayer. Peter taught me that work need not be just a hard slog, but could be fun as well. He managed to teach me the finer points of painting over the telephone, which stood me in good stead for a 15-year-long successful business career. Peter's innovative sandwich filling of beetroot and parsley remains my favorite to this day. I will never forget the cayenne pepper challenge. The more in the soup, the greater the agony, the more profuse the sweat. We were both very brave, I think. I looked up to him as my older brother, but Peter always treated me as an equal. I knew I could approach him with any question or problem, in spite of our age difference. He did not judge, he was honest, and I felt safe and supported. My memories as Peter's little shadow continue. It was wartime during Peter's early years, and when the Russians approached Görlitz, Mutti took us, four small children, and fled with many others to the west. We were accommodated on a farm in Bavaria, and we grew healthy and fat. But after about 18 months, we returned to Görlitz to await the return of our father, who was a prisoner of war in Russia. When Peter turned 10, our family moved from Görlitz to Falkenstein, a little township in East Germany. It was during the 4 years of residing there that the bond between Peter and myself was cemented. He was my big brother, and I loved him. And he was fun, and always managed to think of exciting things to do. Peter arranged a signal. If he left the living room whistling, I was to follow soon after, and then we would hatch up some mischief. This invariably got us into trouble, and my mother's swift punishment, if not avoided, left us consoling each other. Our adventures led us to supplement our meager post-war diet with fruit of various kinds, gleaned when available. I was small enough to slip through gaps in fences and help the windfalls while Peter stood guard. Or he would let me stand on his back so I could climb over the fence. This activity stopped when one day Mutti found a hoard of pears under our beds. She took Peter, plus the pears, to the owner of the orchard where he had to confess. The kind, wise owner gave him a basket full of other pears, which he said we could enjoy with a clear conscience. But Peter returned home very subdued, and we did not enjoy those pears. One winter's day, we decided to have a bit of fun, dropping snowballs from an upstairs window onto unsuspecting pedestrians who used a small lane at the back of the house. One man took exception to this and made his way to the front to buttonhole the culprit. Peter, aware that he was would be in serious trouble, hid in the furthest corner of the coal cellar while he sent me out to face the man. Fortunately, I must have looked innocent enough, for the man took pity on me. However, we did not always get into trouble, but spent beautiful, carefree days together. In summer, Peter would invariably drag me out of bed while everyone else was still fast asleep. We would wash the accumulated dirty dishes from the day before and get the breakfast table ready to give Mutti a surprise. Other times we would go into the forest and return with buckets full of blueberries or bags of mushrooms. Peter enjoyed doing things to make others happy, especially Mutti. Once we pooled a meager supply of hard-earned pocket money and Peter bought a dinner set to give Mutti something beautiful. Throughout his life, Peter could never tolerate cracked pottery, broken or superfluous things. He was a minimalist, even if it meant throwing a few things overboard or into the rubbish bin, much to the consternation of family members. However, giving others pleasure was an integral part of Peter's makeup. As young children, we would pick bunches of meadow flowers and search out elderly people to surprise them and bring happiness into their lives. At age 14, Peter's childhood came to an abrupt halt. In order for our family to get out of East Germany, my three older siblings were placed into service. Peter became a farm laborer and was very unhappy. Later, our family reunited. Peter was apprenticed to a well drilling company, and he carried the scar of a missing fingertip due to that occupation. In 1958, our family faced another life-changing event. We immigrated to Australia. What challenges! But Peter, aged 17, embraced these new experiences with enthusiasm, especially as girls found this handsome young fellow fascinating. Employment at the Sanitarium Health Food Company provided Peter with the means to get a motorbike, the pride of his life. However, after three progressively more serious accidents, he decided that four wheels would be safer. Several years passed, during which time Peter not only conquered the English language, but also the heart of an 18-year-old lovely girl. In due course, Peter and Wendy were married, but sadly the relationship did not last. Separation and divorce followed, but not before Wendy found herself to be pregnant with twin girls. It has only been recently that Peter allowed himself to get to know Esther and Helena, and I know it brought peace to his heart, and I hope it brings comfort to the girls and also to Wendy and Waldemar at this time. The divorce brought a dark time for Peter, but gradually healing took place. Then one day he asked me out for dinner. He wanted me to meet somebody. And there sat an attractive lady with a small, shy, coy little smile, which Celia never lost, and Peter was comforted. Peter and Celia married in 1969 and established their home, which was soon blessed by the arrival of a baby girl, Joanna. Peter was so proud. Rebecca followed 2 years later, and then Ben and Imus. I think that then Peter's quiver was full, or maybe he got scared of how he would provide for them. He worked hard as a bricklayer with his father and hated it. He tried his hand at painting, but the fumes were not good for his health. He went into farming, hard, back-breaking work, and lastly became a postie, which he loved. Celia stood faithfully by his side with all the ups and downs which life throws at everyone. It was June this year when Peter asked me whether I would like to go to Lismore with him for a few days. He wanted to revisit his old postal haunts, and maybe we could get into mischief together. We didn't, but it was a precious 6 days, and I didn't know my brother could talk so much. We tumbled from one reminisce into another, and I was glad to observe that his quirky sense of humor had not forsaken him. While there, we had humongous meals, Peter being the chief cook. Whatever went into the pot had to come out of it and be eaten. Actually, Peter's interest in culinary affairs goes back many years. From a young boy, he more often than not was in the kitchen before dinner, sniffing, stirring, tasting. On more than one occasion, he actually saved the meal from becoming a burnt offering. This interest followed him into the kitchen of his home, and the statement that too many cooks spoil the broth left him unimpressed. In July, I travelled to Adelaide and visited with Peter and Celia for another 6 days. Precious memories. Peter was again proud to show me the garden, the firewood neatly stacked, the bottle collection, everything nice and orderly. The three of us going for daily walks, beanies pulled over our ears to keep warm, having good laughs together. Celia, with her gentle strength and her shy, coy little smile, always made me and my family feel welcome. It wasn't supposed to have been the last visit, but it was. On August 29, Peter and Celia were involved in a fatal car accident on the air highway while traveling home to Adelaide. There are many hearts here that are hurting, but particularly my four nieces and nephews, Joanna, Rebecca, Ben, Amos. Though your parents are gone, one beautiful thing remains. I know their prayers for each of you ascended daily to God and are stored in the throne room of a heavenly Father. Take courage and trust yourselves into the loving arms of Jesus. He promises and he says, "My grace is sufficient for you." We can then look forward to meeting Peter and Celia again. What a wonderful reunion that will be.
We'll now share in viewing some memories of Peter in pictures. And we would just like to acknowledge the effort that went in to preparing these slideshows by Ian Martin, Rebecca's fiancé. So if the guys can start that, we'll view the slideshows now. The slideshow, the photos, memories of Peter. Sorry, guys, I'm going to have to interrupt. That's the wrong slideshow. I think just the one of Peter. Yeah. Got to get it right. So I'll give some instructions to the back. There's one of Celia, one of Peter, and one of them both. So there we go. Good stuff.
Pilgrim.
Now I'll share some memories of Celia. And I like to call Erica Hoffman. Erica is a close friend of Celia. And I'm just going from memory, but I believe that the words that we're going to hear were requested to be translated. Is that right? Not so long ago by Celia. So Erica, if you could come forward and present that reading.
Just preface this by saying that on the 9th of August, which is my birthday, the usual card from Celia came, and she began with a normal greeting, happy birthday, Erica, and so on, and then she added, I do believe that it's almost 60 years that we've been friends, and what a blessing it's been to share this long friendship from our youth to our old age. And I did my sums, it was actually 58 years, so she overstated it. But I can say to all the children and family of Celia's that it was a friendship that was a blessing in so many ways, and she stayed close to my heart all my life. And we could speak about spiritual things together, as well as the girlish and the mother things as well. Now, this prayer rose out of the fact that we shared some of these thoughts together, and I have a very old Lithuanian hymn book, which I sometimes translate, and various hymns that have meaning for me. And this is an evening hymn. It begins in the verse that I didn't include, which gives God thanks for the day that has just passed, and now the heart is preparing for the evening. And so this is the evening plea. Come now, throw your mantle over my house and over me. shroud my burdens too, chase them away, send them away. Come, Lord, take me under your wing. A foundling and orphan I be. Cover me, care for me. Stay hands that would harm me. Be my sleep's guardian. Now I will be quiet, resting in your mercy. Give myself to you now, soul and body laying into your gracious hands, into your faithful keeping. And when again you wake me and in the morning raise me, still at my side you'll be. This is offered with love to Celia.
Celia's eulogy will be read by Roger Hankel, Celia's younger brother, and Rebecca Thiel, one of Peter and Celia's daughters.
Celia Mary Thiel, née Hankel, was born on the 3rd of December 1939 at Henty, near Wagga Wagga in New South Wales. She was the fifth of nine children born to Erhard Christoph Benjamin Hankel and Elfrieda Gertrude Hankel, née Koch. Her mother recalled that the hospital was a weatherboard building, unshaded, no air conditioning or fans. The iron bedsteads were hot to touch. Fortunately, Celia was born in the cool early morning before sunrise. Celia's early childhood was spent at Waldeck, a 1,000-acre property near Henty, selected by her grandfather in 1884. In the words of her mother, she was a golden girl, fine flaxen curly hair, hazel eyes later, and fair skin. She was usually happy, smiling and laughing. Celia walked and talked early, constantly encouraged by her older siblings, Margaret, Mark, Rosemary and John. They took her for walks in the gate paddock with its spreading box trees, numerous birds, wildflowers and carpets of buttercups. All families have their games, and spoonerisms were big in the Hankel household. At the age of five, Celia walked into a shop and asked for a frocklet chog. At this time, frocklet chogs, or chocolate frogs even, would have been in short supply because these were the war years and a time of strict rationing. Being on a large farm, the family was well supplied with milk, butter, meat and eggs, and Frieda grew as many vegetables as she could to keep her family healthy, although water for this was sometimes in short supply. When Celia was six, their ex-army international truck was packed with a piano, dining table, seven children and other possessions, including a bedroom suite, and I don't know how they got it all on, but they did. Because Waldeck had been put onto the market so that the family could move to South Australia to better attend to the children's education needs. Celia, with her four older siblings, rode on the back of the truck and could talk to their parents through a hatch in the cabin roof. It was an arduous journey, but exciting too. There were a few nights of roadside camping on rugs under the stars. After several temporary homes in the Harndorf area, the family purchased Akuna, a 100-acre farm at Verdun. Predominantly a dairy farm, there was also a pear orchard and large areas of untouched bush. With numerous ferny gullies, shady springs and creeks, and trees to climb, it was a wonderful place for adventurous children. The Adelaide to Melbourne rail line bordered the property, and Celia and some siblings once ran through a rather long tunnel nearby, which was very brave, even if there was a train strike that day. During her school years, Celia was evidently sometimes called Cherub, due to her goodness and sunny disposition. Beneath her angelic demeanour, there was a great strength of character and a steely determination to stick to whatever was right, fair, and above all, honest. And you know, I sometimes think Celia was a bit, even back then, I thought Celia was just a bit too good. Because her mum and dad came to think that that was normal. And that made it rather hard for the younger kids coming after her. In fact, I really think that for every time I got the strap, it had to be Celia's fault, at least for a little bit, because she was just such a goody two-shoes. There, I've said it. When Lois started school, Celia dinked her there on the back of her bike for the first year. Thereafter, the three sisters, Celia, Eleanor and Lois, and later Roger, rode the 6-mile return trip to Harndorf for school every day. Sometimes they would take a shortcut through a neighbour's orchard, although Mr. Schmidtke's militant geese made this a route not to be embarked on lightly. They were fearsome. At Mount Barker High School, Celia was ducks of all her first year classes and house captain. She also excelled in athletics, later winning the Senior Cup, which sat proudly on her desk for some years. In 1955, again, due mainly to the educational requirements of the children, but also our father's advancing years, a kooner was sold and the family moved to Myrtle Bank. In order to complete her intermediate certificate at Mount Barker High School, Celia boarded in Harndorf during the week for the rest of that year, staying with Mrs. Whitwer, a family friend and also a piano teacher for many of the family. After leaving school, Celia gained a position at Harris Scarf and then was asked to become secretary in the Lutheran Hour office in Pirie Street, where she worked for 8 years. Her work included management of a correspondence Sunday school for children in remote areas. Here, Celia met her lifelong friend, Erica. Erica has been kind enough to share some memories and special insights from those youthful years into Celia's life. So in Erica's words, "To me, at the age of 14, Celia was a first encounter as a workmate. She was the senior girl in the office who was kind and sensitive in her mentoring, but firm as well, and always with that quick smile, a slight turn of the head, and a giggle too." Celia lived in a rambling home, always full of a great variety of children and interesting young adults. A strong and stable household, not perfect, but vigorous and warm, held together by faithful parents whose lives had not been easy. Celia was a searcher and she was a thinker. Her cultural interests were broad. She loved music and singing. She listened to and understood classical music, and her family was blessed with capable and gifted people. It was with Celia's encouragement and planning that we attended the first ever Adelaide Festival of Arts. We saw exotic films from all over the world and plays and exhibitions of fantastic Australian paintings. We attended free lectures on high-minded subjects, and during those heady days, we sat on the lawns along the River Tines, listening to music and languidly smoking cigarettes. Wonder if Mum knew about that. Still in Erica's words, Celia and I spent a few days together at a guest house at Port Elliot. This was such a special holiday. We lay on the beach, we read books, we talked, we watched the clouds. The world was lovely, our heads were full of ideas and hopes. Our hearts had ventured just a little into the realms of romance. But into those dreamy moments, the harsh reality of life delivered severely sunburnt legs. Thank you, Erica, for sharing those special memories with us. In about 1964, Celia went to New Guinea for 2.5 years as secretary for several American missionaries amongst the Enga people at Wabag in Papua New Guinea Highlands. She attended a 3-month Enga language school, and in Pidgin English, she taught 6 young New Guinean men typing and other office skills. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Erica can remember Celia teaching her a few words of Pidgin English.
No, that's me, actually.
Oh. Okay. Beck can remember Celia teaching her a few words of Pidgin English, but the only thing that has stuck is dispella emi long long true, which Beck thinks means you're not quite right in the head. Did she say it to you? No.
Yeah.
On return to Adelaide from New Guinea, Celia looked into the possibility of training as a social worker or a deaconess, but eventually took up the position of secretary to the director of overseas missions at Lutheran House in North Adelaide. You're on.
Thank you. Stay here to kick me if I cry. Celia met Peter in a car park. None of us are quite sure on the finer detail of this, but I can remember Mum saying he was sitting in his car looking at me with his ducky beak eyes. I've never really understood exactly what that meant, but we do know it was a precursor to a lifelong partnership with Peter. The wedding took place on 21st June 1969 at Bethlehem Lutheran Church in Adelaide, with the reception in North Adelaide. I'm sure it was a wonderful event with many special memories created for Celia, Peter, family and friends. It seems that one of the most lasting memories for many, however, was the kidnapping of the bride. A German tradition where the bride is kidnapped by family and returned to the groom only after he negotiates a ransom. Peter's sister Anita, her husband Fred, and Celia's brother Roger duly kidnapped and photographed Mum at Victoria Fountain in the middle of Adelaide. But then Anita tells us that they were so upset at being separated that the negotiation process was waived and Mum was returned to her husband forthwith. A year-long honeymoon travelling around Australia in a Morris Minor followed, with much sleeping in the back of the car. During our childhoods, we had slide nights of these times Mum and Dad spent together. Mum loved the Australian countryside, and seeing them enjoying this and each other's company up on a screen in a darkened lounge room is a special childhood memory. They settled into 8 Bellevue Street Vista, and over the next 3.5 years, Joanna, Rebecca and Benjamin joined them. Amos came along four years later. Mum's intense desire to raise us in a pure, pollution-free environment led us to move to Yundi near Mount Compass in 1980. This run-down old property, complete with outside bucket toilet, had its challenges, but I think Mum took great pleasure in watching us grow fitter and stronger, roaming barefoot over 30 acres until the bottoms of our feet were like leather. Mum gave excellent foot massages. We moved to the Barossa Valley in 1983, then on to Bimbardine in northern New South Wales in 1985. The pure spring water, gentle climate and sheer beauty of the natural environment was just right, and this remained the family home until 2009, when they returned to South Australia to be closer to family. After spending some time on Kangaroo Island, they purchased a home in beautiful Macclesfield in the Adelaide Hills, with its own creek and a reserve at the back. Here, Mum immersed herself in the lovely family atmosphere of the church she had left behind so many years before. This was something she had missed and gave her much fulfilment and pleasure. Here, she was known and loved by all for her dedication, social skills, and hard work. From the moment we were born, Celia's career was the upbringing and nurturing of her children. Taking on the task of home educating four children with their varying educational requirements demonstrates the level of Mum's dedication to us. As Ben and Amos needed a little more attention in the early years of their education, Joanna and I were sometimes left to our own devices. I was smart enough to find the answers in the back of the book anyhow. Mum would have been horrified had she known the extent of my cheating in maths. But many were the times we heard her say, "Be sure your sin will find you out." I think we have demonstrated that our mother was entirely up to the task of our education. Between us, we have two university degrees, an advanced diploma of naturopathy, and a Minister of Religion qualification. I will admit to a very wobbly start in statistics and economics at university, as my sin did indeed eventually find me out. As at the age of 27, I painstakingly mastered the basic algebra I should have learned in year 10. At least I had Mum's excellent advice to fall back on. If at first you don't succeed, try again. An avid reader and self-educator, Mum kept copious notes for which she kept recycled paper, carefully cut to A5 size by the phone. In her last notes, we found her research on funerals, natural funerals in particular, which we're incredibly grateful for. Mum took diet and health very seriously, and in her last notes, we also found the words, "Eat yourself smart." This sums up beautifully Mum's ongoing self-education on food and herbs. She studied carefully the specific aspects of each nut, seed, herb, and other food that came to her notice, wanting to truly understand not only their nutritional value, but also their other health benefits. She was far ahead of her time. Whenever the latest wonder food hits the market, quinoa, chia, almond milk, goji, you name it, the odds are we have already learned about its benefits through my mother's encyclopedic knowledge of the blessings of nature. Many people have commented over the years, and more recently, of the beautiful nature of my mother, the quiet helpfulness, the non-judgmental listening skills, and the gentle understanding that she exuded was no accident, but was arrived at through many hours of Bible reading, meditation, and prayer. Again, with her natural curiosity, intelligence, and ability to self-educate, I think my mother often found that peace that passeth understanding and was able to share it with those around her. Of course, she had her struggles, as we all do. She once told me about her struggle with pride. I remember telling her I certainly didn't see her as overly proud. And she confessed that sometimes she was proud of being humble. And in my view, rightly so. For someone so grounded, so thoughtful, and so organised, the time and effort it took my mother to choose an outfit always amazed me. "What shall I wear today?" she would ask. Her chosen victim would follow her into the bedroom to see several outfits laid neatly on the bed, and be required to discuss the merits of each at length. When Erica told me she had the dubious honour of helping Mum shop for a special new frock for her 21st birthday, a story she finished with the words, "The things we do for love," I realised this was a lifelong idiosyncrasy. Hearing the stories of how Celia has helped and encouraged so many of us over the years with her soothing presence, non-judgmental listening, and kind and gentle advice continues to be a great comfort to all of us. If we continue to practice and share these skills that she so humbly demonstrated throughout her life, not only will we be helping others, but we will also keep her in our hearts for many years to come.
It's time for a few pictures.
Shoulders, you raise me up
We'll now call Celia's older sister, Rosemary Windelich, to read some words of comfort.
This is from the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 to 3 and verse 27. Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid.
So now we'll hear some from the children. And first we'll ask Esther to come forward. She's one of Peter's older children.
Dad, in my heart and mind, you are always going to be around for a long time. Because our story had just begun. But now that you have gone, it seems like I was just getting to know you. Your deep thoughtfulness, charisma, sense of humour, and your consider all motto were values that stood out. My fondest memory of you is your sense of humour. I would think it and you would say it. This has taught me to lighten up a bit and just be myself. Birthday cards from you often included a quote. One I'd like to read out today. Love. Love all and our fears, judgments and need to control will fade from this world. Just love all. With deep sadness, I say farewell until I meet you once again.
Amos will have his notes ready shortly. Amos, the youngest.
There is a destiny available to every one of us on this planet. The destiny to become love, to be the best us that we can possibly be. A person can become a fountain of hope, healing, encouragement, and stability to everyone around them. Our mother was such a person. And only in the light of recent events have I come to realize just how many people she touched and how many people she inspired. In her, there was a serenity, a sweet, empathetic social nature, and a deep sincerity. Some have described her as angelic, and as we look at her ability to help and touch others, we know that her fountain was fed by one much deeper, one who is the definition of love itself. In her we see a love not easily provoked, that thinks no evil. She always gave others the benefit of the doubt, was always thinking of another's good. Mum suffered long. She was kind. She bore all things and believed all things, and there was a very deep humility about her. We can be inspired too by my father's life, by his long but successful battle against his nerves. To watch and see him unwind and mellow, and that quirky, inappropriate sense of humour that was always present come out to play. We can be inspired too by the brutal honesty that led him to step outside of the arena of his faith for a while because he felt that his life did not match his profession. Something that breathes like a breath of fresh air in a world so full of hypocrisy, facades, and disappointing illusions of love. Among those who knew him best, Dad was a steady and unbiased voice. He was never afraid to speak the truth and would never back down for the sake of saving face or looking good in the opinions of others. This is what made people value his advice so much. For years, on church business meetings, I used to watch as his name would be 5 or 10 votes ahead of all the rest while a committee was voted in. He helped even beyond his ability, even at times when probably he should have taken a break for the sake of his nerves. In recent times, he was known to have said that the only thing that kept him from fully joining the little church he attended here in Adelaide was because he knew he wouldn't be able to say no to responsibilities that he wasn't able to bear. His perfectionism and his desire to have things a certain way did drive us crazy. But Dad, we love you and thank you so much for sharing your life with us. When we understand your language of hard work, support, and hugs, we know truly that here was a heart where love lived. Whether it was a good deal on the first car, financial help in times of need, or sound advice, you were always willing to help. Of all Mum and Dad's children, I feel I owe them the most gratitude. They stood by me at a difficult time in my life, a time when illness wasted my body and left my mind in a confused haze of forgetfulness and inability to think straight. As days went by and then dragged into weeks, and weeks dragged into months, and months became years, hope became less certain, but they were there every step of the way. It was an incredibly hard 2 years. I know it took a heavy toll on them, but they were there for me, patiently, quietly, caring. They didn't institutionalize me, and as a result, I stand here today. Of all things that inspire about our parents, none shines so brightly as their commitment to each other. They were so different, and there were rocky times along the road that tested that dedication to the limit. But they stood by each other at times when many others would have simply washed their hands and walked away. Now, even in death, they remain together, proving that true love endures all things. For us, this is a really hard time, but for them, this was most likely quite easy. It is very likely that one day we will have this conversation with them. What happened? We seem to have dropped out for a while. What? There was a car accident? A head-on? really, we are so sorry that you had to go through that. And then, forever. I think that if today just one person can be shaken up and shaken out of their contentedness with living small, of being less, and become a fountain of hope and healing, then it will give meaning to loss and beauty to pain. Mum and Dad, I love you. Thank you so much for sharing your life with me, with us, and with the world.
Esther's twin, Helena, which is Peter's daughter, sent a message to be read. She says this: "We had the good fortune of Peter and Celia staying with us for a few days when they came to Kangaroo Island. It was so lovely to get to know them a bit better. Auntie Celia and I talked plants, and I enjoyed her gentle nature. Papa Peter told stories from the past, which we loved to hear. They both came with me on my power walk and nearly left me in the dust." Gulp. "On later visits, Papa Peter always brought a little gift to share. He couldn't resist a bargain, and I will never look at pine nuts the same way. They will always remind me of him. He enjoyed my butter cushion, something like that, and I couldn't resist a third piece when offered. My family and I treasure that we had the chance to get reacquainted, and we will dearly miss them. We will keep them in our hearts forever. Helena and family." Now we'll call forward Joanna and Ben.
It's been said that children are a gift to parents. But looking at the lives of our parents, which have been snatched from us all too soon, we have to conclude that parents are also a gift to children. Over the years we've had our loved parents with us, we've all received something from them. Whether it's mum's tact, consistency, organisation, tolerance, her endless writing of lists, which some of us used to tease her she needed to write an index for, her love of finding something good quality in a second-hand store hunt, or her properness, which I'm not sure any of us actually absorbed. We all receive something. While Mum might have seemed to have many of the softer characteristics, she was by no means lenient in our upbringing. Very early, we were given a small sum of pocket money each week, which was debited in 20 to 50 cent increments according to our misdeeds, causing pain and tears in others, and who cares, you can take it all in others, at which other discipline methods were employed. For us, at least part of our education was completed via homeschooling, and here some stronger characteristics also came out. If our time for breaks was exceeded, the whistle was blown with more than usual energy, and we had to rush in or face the consequences. Receiving the "I can't do that" plea on one occasion, her reaction was, "Just sit down and say to yourself, I can, I will, and I must." Bringing up four lively, opinionated individuals is not for the faint-hearted, and our mother did admirably at the task. often running through all of our names, Joanna, Rebecca, Benjamin, Amos, before arriving at the right individual to intervene in some minor catastrophe in the house. Or, Rowena, Rebecca, Benjamin, can you please get this or that? Mum's calm air in the midst of difficulty was always amazing. On one occasion when Dad was away working in the country, we were late for church. Once on the way, Mum was driving at a very rapid rate and singing as she often did. When Amos, aged about 5 at the time, asked, "Mum, what's that smell?" To which she calmly answered, "Oh, it's the car on fire because we're late." The next week, the car was to be booked in for a service, and Mum was there on the phone, looking all official with her notepad and making the booking. And when asked, "What sort of car do you have, Mrs. Thiel?" Mum pulled one of those well-practiced funny faces, raised one eyebrow and said, "Well, it's green and, it has 4 wheels. Mum's musings sometimes landed her in trouble, and sometimes she caught herself saying things before realising their possible impact. I remember the name of an island, a friend, being mentioned in conversation one day. And Mum said in a thoughtful tone, "He's a nice young man, rather angelic, like a dark angel." Upon realisation of the statement's import, it was hurriedly but carefully corrected, causing great amusement to all present. Mum spent 3 years in Papua New Guinea, where she as a young person reached out to touch the lives of others there. As I've travelled the Pacific Islands over the last 15 years, I've realised that the 3 years Mum spent in PNG affected her life in more ways than I'd previously known. Her straightforward, unassuming down-to-earthness, her love of the natural, her lack of being rushed on time the way the Western world demands it, and other things about her general demeanour resonate with the people there. Travelling back there with her in 2009, it was interesting to see how Whitegrass Mary, as they called her, fitted in, understood the people, and how quickly the language she hadn't spoken for 40 years came back to her again.
Dad taught us how to work hard, be frugal, make do, not hoard, was brutally honest, and he was level-headed in whatever advice he gave. He had a quirky and sometimes inappropriate sense of humour, which, though it sometimes embarrassed us, we loved him just the same. Though his bad nerves and allergies often made him edgy, he was never condescending but would apologise to us for being a bad dad, which gave us more respect for him than anything else he could have done. Dad worked hard and fast and taught us from little on to work. We remember the rows of carrots and radishes we helped thin on the farm near Mount Compass. From a child's perspective, they seemed kilometres long. As we got older, we shifted to northern New South Wales, to Bimbadeen, a beautiful 13-acre property overlooking the Nimbin Valley, about 30 kilometres from Lismore, New South Wales. It was a place where plants grew incredibly well and the weeds were even better. For us, it was strange and different. There were tropical fruits that we'd never heard of before, strange sounds from night singing cicadas, and the people were different too. Alternative lifestylers, otherwise referred to as hippies, roamed the hills of Nimbin, and it took some getting used to the locals. This was to be the home of our parents for the next 25 years. After preparing the ground, 200 custard apple trees, 60 mango trees and numerous other fruit trees such as bananas, pawpaws and avocados were planted. There was always a huge vegetable garden. Bimbadeen became a hobby farm, providing lots of fresh fruit and vegetables for the family and friends and some income. All this meant plenty of work for everyone, and we'd often we'd all hoe weeds in the orchard before enjoying a trip to the local swimming hole in the creek down the road. During our school holidays, Dad took us macadamia nut picking. He was unstoppable. Even when we had to pick nuts covered in ice in winter, he would just rub his hands in the prickly leaves till they were warm and keep going. We had races who could pick the most nuts in a day, and boy was Dad hard to beat. Once or twice we would manage to do a proper job of it after quietly hiding a few buckets and powering on as hard as we could. Dad worked part of the day delivering mail on a local country postal run. This was Dad's happiest time of employment. He loved his run and the casual contact with so many people. Initially, he felt guilty that he enjoyed it so much and spoke of having to adjust his thinking to believe that this could actually be called work at all. On coming home, he would often keep us amused with stories of accidentally wiping out a letterbox or another hair-raising adventure on the narrow mountain roads. There was one about a carpet snake too, wasn't there? In somebody's letterbox. Dead one. During this time, we left the nest one by one. Dad had his postal run, but it was lonely for Mum, so she also became a postie for a while and later delivered meals on wheels and also volunteered in the local SDA secondhand shop. Dad's stories were fascinating, and he told them with his whole heart and emotion. I remember people nearly in tears as he told the story of Robust and Tenderheart, two lettuces who lived to make people healthy, but never got to fulfil their life's purpose because they died in the back of the fridge before they were eaten. Or his parable of the wolf who was offered an operation to become a sheep but refused and instead became the wolf in sheep's clothing. On one occasion, Dad's frugality led him to attempt to persuade us that we did not require a proper saddle for our flighty, poorly trained 3-year-old Arab horse Bubbles.
A perfectly good saddle could be made from a Hessian sack, he said. After much careful measuring and stitching, the saddle was attached, and as we naturally refused to mount up, Dad did the honours himself. We all watched on in fear and amusement as he trialled this homemade contraption. Just a few steps down the road proved our need for a real saddle, as Dad nearly came to grief. He quickly found himself on the road with one leg caught up in the reins high above his head while still being pulled along by a very scared Bubbles. Needless to say, a real saddle was quickly forthcoming, which provided us with many more successful horse adventures after that. Through his struggles as a young person, Dad sought a steady, consistent, loving relationship to fill a hole in his heart, as reflected in the words of poetry which he wrote many years ago.
Have you ever stopped and pondered? Or have you never wondered of which in life we need the most? To some, no doubt, it's fortune, wealth, which they must acquire no matter what the cost. They even go as far as to sacrifice their health. Health. Yes, that's important, even vital, but many waste it and do not mind until it's late or fatal. Sometimes I wonder, is it importance, fame? I observe the ones who on this mountain climb. How hard they try to reach their goal. Little realise how they lose their soul. They do not shrink from fraud or bad. Care little whom they hurt or make sad. Lord, preserve me from the urge for fame. For it costs your all and all your time. Maybe it is to be content, but let me ask you, friend, is it possible to be in such a state of mind if you have no resting pole of any kind? That's important too, a resting pole, someone, somewhere, who can console. More subjects could well be considered, but my mind for them has withered. For me, the important thing in life is to have a good and loving wife. How otherwise shall I be content, or happily my time be spent? Through woman, men do stand or fall. Through them, we're either big or small. You may admit or you may forbear. Your state depends on the one with whom your life you share. Though Mum and Dad found each other in an unusual way, the 45 years that they had together are proof that Dad found what he was looking for in Mum. And despite their ups and downs, the good times and the fiery ordeals, we know that they loved and cared for each other and stuck together. Finally, they were both snatched from us by a fiery ordeal, marked by an ugly black full stop in the middle of the air highway, taken too soon to our human understanding to grasp, and so suddenly, but together in the hope of Jesus' soon coming, to conquer the enemy called death. We miss Mum and Dad, but value what they have given us and share the hope that one day soon they'll be raised to be together with us again. Amos and I would like to now share a song, attempt to share, be with us if our emotions do a funny thing.
I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above. If I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal ken. And I'm sure He would grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all the sorrows and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, as we stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all the heartaches troubles are vanished away. Then we'll have joy, the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
Just to finish the time of remembering, there have been a few more pictures that have been prepared of Peter and Celia together. And the music behind this slideshow is actually sung by their granddaughters, Nina and Zara. And so we'll ask, guys, if you can play that now. The song is called You've Got a Friend.
Nothing is going.
It's time to say goodbye, and so I'd like you to join in singing a hymn which is actually Peter's favorite, and it's in the program booklet which has his name and photograph on it, called O Thou to Whose All-Searching Light. Once again, when the music begins, let's stand.
As we remain standing, let us bow our heads in prayer. Our gracious, loving Father in heaven, we're so thankful to you that whenever we go through trials and difficulties, that you are still there to give us comfort and to give us strength to endure the trials that we go through. At this time, in a special way, we ask you, Holy Spirit, may be with each member of the Thiel family and the friends that were very close to Ben and Celia. We ask you that you may give them the special comforter today. We come to the conclusion of pondering upon the lives that they've lived here, the time of grace that you have given them. And we are assured that they have a hope, that this is not the end. They have a hope in the resurrection. We ask you, Holy Spirit, may protect them and guard, put a watch over them until that special day when life will come again and we can see Jesus. We ask that you may be with each one of us that are here, that in our hearts and in our minds we may resolve, that we may truly dedicate ourselves to you, so that we can continue this friendship on the other side. Bless us throughout the rest of this day. And once again, may your mercy be with the families as they mourn their loved ones. In Jesus' name we pray and thank you. Amen.
Please be seated. I just have a few announcements. At this time, we're going to move from the church outside to farewell Peter and Celia. Now, there will be flowers given out at the door, and you're invited to take a flower and lay it outside. Everyone is welcome to come to the hall, which is just up the hill, afterwards for refreshments and a time of sharing. I'm sure you have a few memories to share, those we didn't hear from today, and to just be there for the family. So please come along if you have the time to come and spend time with us there. So at this time, I'll invite the pallbearers to come forward and the congregation to stand.
This will be the front end.